Hello, this is Betty Allen from Central Pennsylvania, and you are listening to Heaven Bound.
I see a city. I see my home. I see my
good morning again, friends, and welcome one more time to Heaven Bound. On behalf of the good folks here at Calvary Bible Church, I am Doug Benedict, and Pastor Jim Jenkins will be joining us just a little bit later on after some information about the church, as well as some great music that we have handpicked for you this morning. And if this is your very first time tuning in, we do hope that you get a blessing today out of the great Southern gospel music, as well as the great preaching from God's Word. And we hope we can make a change in your life, and you will be willing to come seek out how you can know for sure that you are going to heaven when you die. And actually, we hope you know that by the end of the program. And we hope that you'll write to us and tell us how much you enjoy the program and that you have actually made a decision to start following God. So if this is your first time joining us, we are a small congregation located in Gregg, New York. This program is sponsored by Calvary Bible Church. If you want to come visit us, put in your GPS 6968 Sweeney Road, Gregg, New York. It'll get you just about here, but you will have to pay attention after you turn onto Sweeney Road because sometimes it takes you too far. So you can also take these super easy directions. If you're coming out of Boonville, head north on Route 12 and make a right-hand turn onto Burdick's Crossing Road. If you're coming out of Lowville, head south on Route 12 and make a left-hand turn onto Burdick's Crossing Road. If you're coming out of West Leiden, head north on 26, keep straight onto 12D, head north on Route 12, and make a right-hand turn onto Burdick's Crossing Road. Take Burdick's Crossing Road all the way to the end. Make a left-hand turn onto Gregg Road, head up the hill, and make your first right-hand turn onto Sweeney Road. And we'll be up there about 200 yards on the right-hand side. Now, if you would like to come but you don't have a ride, give us a call this morning. Our number here is 315-348-6271. Or you can even send an email to cbclewiscounty@gmail.com. And we'll do our best to line someone up to come pick you up. And as always, if nothing else works, you can check us out online at cbclewiscounty.com, as well as on livestream.com, and soon we will be on Facebook Live as well. Now, with this being the fourth Sunday of the month, we'll begin our services this morning at 9 o'clock with our fellowship breakfast. Then at 9:30, we'll have Sunday school. And at 10:30, we'll have our morning service, and we'll be out of here by noon. Now, tonight at 6 o'clock, we'll have an evening service, and we'll also have a midweek service on Wednesday, and that'll begin at 7 o'clock p.m. for our Bible study and prayer group sessions. Put all those down on your calendar and come visit us for all of those times. And all those times, we do have a nursery provided for you. So you can bring all your infants and toddlers along with you. We have highly trained mothers and volunteers just waiting to watch your children for you. Another thing for you men, October 21st, we are going to have a men's breakfast here at Calvary Bible Church. Everything is going to be provided. Just come and visit with us and have some great food. Now in the Bible, there's been multiple people that have had some major issues. Some of them tried just about anything up to like spending all their money on doctors. None of them got any better, and some of them actually got worse the more they tried. They had absolutely no hope of getting better until one day they found the ultimate fix. So as I leave you hanging on that note, if you have your Bibles, turn to Mark chapter 5. Beginning in verse 25, and preacher will come fill you in more about what that great fix was. So again, as you're turning to Mark chapter 5, let's listen to the Collingsworth family as they sing, Gotta Get to Jesus.
My physicians tried in vain, but 12 long years of pain is proof that there is nothing they can do. But I just heard somebody say, there's a healer on the way. Somehow I have to press my way through. I've gotta get to Jesus. Gotta get to Jesus. I know that he's the answer to my need. Bring him all my problems. Only he can solve them. Mend the broken pieces. Gotta get to Jesus. When my world is torn apart, I need healing for my heart. I really don't know how much more I can take. Trapped inside a cloud of disbelief and doubt, I only know one way of escape. I've gotta get to Jesus. Gotta get to Jesus. I know that he's the answer to my need. Bring him all my problems. Only he can solve them. Mend the broken pieces.
And that was the Collingsworth family got to bring it to Jesus. And that's so true. Boy, folks, if we could only understand and realize that. So we get started today. Let me say again, I'm glad for everybody that tunes us in each week. Boy, I meet people all the time that hear us. And we've got people all the way from down around Boonville area, all the way up in the High Market, and people up toward Lowellville. Just really a ton of folks who hear us all the time. And many times I meet people and they don't know me, but they, for whatever reason, God has given me the voice that I have. And, you know, it's like, I know you, you're that guy on the radio. Well, yes, I am. And So we're appreciative. I mean that, so appreciative, all the folks who tune us in each week. And I'll tell you what, friend, if you'd like to drop us a line, just drop us a line at Calvary Bible Church, Greg, New York, 13345. Tell us you hear the program. It'd be an encouragement to us. But again, I say to you that I tell you, I am always encouraged by the fact that I meet people all the time. I listen to you on the radio. And that encourages me. Well, the song that we played this morning, I have to bring it to Jesus, or bring it to Jesus, something like that. Collingsworth family. You know, that's kind of Bible. In Mark chapter 5, I want to give you two examples today from Mark chapter 5 and Mark chapter 10. In Mark chapter 5, which is a great chapter, I call it a day in the life of Jesus. They had crossed back over to see the Gadarenes, or the Sea of Galilee, and come to the land of the Gadarenes. And there was a man there who was a maniac. He was demon-possessed of many, many demons, 6,000, about 6,000 demons. Nobody could tame him, untamable. They tried to bind him with chains. He cut himself. He was always crying, ran around naked all the time. And nobody could help that dear man until Jesus came. And Jesus comes, casts the demons out. Man's clothed in his right mind now. And he wants to follow Jesus, but he goes home. Christ tells him to go home, tell people what great things the Lord has done. And he went back to Decapolis and began to blaze abroad and tell abroad all the great things that Jesus had done for him. Then a man, immediately after that, named Jairus, comes to Jesus and says, "My little daughter," she was about the age of 12 years old, "my daughter's at the point of death. Would you please come and help us? Would you please come and help us?" And Jesus agrees to go. And something happens in between, which we'll speak about in just a moment. But while they're going, something happens. And while they are delayed, somebody comes from Jairus' house and says, "Why troublest thou the master any further? Thy daughter is dead." Oh, can you imagine? Can you imagine the grief and the overwhelming sense of loss that Jairus must have experienced at that point? "Thy daughter is dead." And Jesus said, "Hang on a minute, I'm going with you." He gets over to the house, and sure enough, the little girl's died. The professional mourners from the funeral home are already there, weeping and wailing, throwing dirt in the air. Jesus said, "She's not dead." And they laughed him to scorn, and he went in, and he took the little girl by the hand and said, "Maid, arise," and she sat up and walked, and she was of the age of 12 years old. Wow, what a day that was. But between the time of healing the maniac of Gadara and healing Jairus' daughter, there's a woman that enters the scene. And she had a medical issue for 12 years. And she had spent every dime that she had. And she wasn't any better. But she was actually worse. The doctors hadn't helped her. All the doctors had done to torment her. And she had spent all of her money on doctors, and they hadn't been able to help her. And the Bible makes it very clear, it says it, that she grew worse. And it says this, that she had suffered many things, rather grew worse. Now look, listen to what it says in Mark 5 and verse 27. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garments, for she said, "If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." She had heard of Jesus, and his fame was everywhere. His ministry was in the first year, second year at this point, and people knew about Jesus. And here's this woman. She had suffered, the Bible says, suffered many things of the physicians. I don't know what they tried to do to help the woman, but she suffered. at their hands grew worse and had spent all of her money. And the Bible says this, when she had heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind to touch his clothes. Before she said this, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know that I shall be made whole. Now, friend, that's faith. If I can just but touch the hem of his garment, I know that I shall be made whole. The Bible says that he was thronged. In other words, there were people all around him pressing upon him, trying to get near him, trying to touch him. And she said, if I could just get there. Boy, she shoved her way through that crowd. Again, the Bible says it was a press. They were pressing upon him. They were thronging Jesus. If I can just get there, I can see him. I can see him. He's right up ahead of me. But there's a ton of people. There's a mass of humanity. But I've got to get there. I have got to get there. If I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know it. He's right in front of me. She falls to the ground and touches the hem of his garment. And dear friend, may I say to you that immediately, whatever her problem was healed. Now Jesus stopped and said, who touched me? And the disciples somewhat incredulously said, what do you mean, who touched you? Don't you see all these people around you and you say somebody touched you? Well, Jesus had noted this, that virtue had gone out of him. And the woman, trembling, came and the crowd kind of parted and she fell at Jesus' feet. And she told him that it was her and what had happened, and that if she said she knew that if she could just touch the hem of his garment, she'd be made whole. And she was. See, friend, I don't care what your problem is, and all of us have problems. Whatever your problem may be, if we can just get it, if we can just get to that throne of grace, that we might find mercy, that we might find help and mercy in the time of need. Now, I'm not saying that being a Christian, all your problems are solved. Really. Some of these people, you know, well, man, if you get saved, you won't have any more problems. That isn't true. Everybody's got problems in this life. There isn't anybody that doesn't have problems. But I'm telling you this, the biggest problem that you have, the worst problem that you have, will be solved. And now you have somebody on your side. The Bible says in one case, the leper came to Jesus and said, if thou wilt, thou canst heal me. And the Bible says he was moved with compassion. And several weeks ago, I said what compassion was. And I'll just briefly say again, it is the sense of seeing a need and being able to fix it. With a leper, Jesus saw what his need was, but he had the ability to fix it. I mean, you can be sympathetic. Man, I'm sorry you got leprosy and have nothing to do with it. But Jesus had compassion, and he not only saw the need, but he had something. He was able to fix it. Friend, the greatest problem that you have is with God, but when you come to Christ, your biggest problem solved. And now God is your father, and Jesus, the Bible says, is our elder brother, and he is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother, and a brother is born for the day of adversity. Oh, we have a friend, a brother in Christ. If you can just bring your problem, and friend, when we know Christ as Savior, he makes intercession for us before the throne of grace. Jesus said to God, I thank you, Father, that you always hear me. Bring it to Christ. There's a second account in Mark. In Mark chapter 10, we read about a man whose name was Bartimaeus. And Bartimaeus was blind. And in those days, there was no social network to help people out like that. There wasn't any Social Security disability. There wasn't any welfare. There wasn't anything like that back in Jesus' day. Nobody to help. nobody to help this man. And he, beggars or blind people would sit by the road begging, and they would have their coat out in front of them, and people would throw money on it. They didn't necessarily have a hat, throw some money in the hat. They had a cloak, a coat that they laid out in front of them. People would throw money on it so that at the end of the day, they might have something, some substance to live on. Bartimaeus is sitting on the road outside of Jericho. Jesus and the disciples are now on their way to Jerusalem. It is now toward the end of the third year of his ministry. He's on his way to Jerusalem, where he will be crucified by the Pharisees, the Sadducees, by the elders, because they all hated him. But Bartimaeus sits outside of Jericho. He may have been from Jericho, doesn't really say, but he was outside of the town. And as he's sitting there begging for alms, he hears a disturbance. Now, again, there are many people that are with Jesus. They're not just his 12 disciples, but good night, there are a lot of people following him just to see him do something. And Bartimaeus asks the question, what's going on? What is it? Is it a parade? Is it a funeral? And notice what it says here. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he evidently had asked somebody what the noise was, what the commotion was. And somebody said, well, it's Jesus of Nazareth coming by. And the Bible says, when he heard that it was Jesus. Now, evidently, Bartimaeus had heard of Christ before. He probably had heard of all the miracles that he'd done. And when somebody said it was Jesus of Nazareth, again, that verse says, when he heard it was Jesus of Nazareth, notice what it says, that he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. There are a lot of people in the crowd said, shut up. We don't have time for an old blind beggar, ma'am. It's like when they brought the little children to Jesus and the disciples said, we don't have time for little kids in this outfit. We got bigger fish to fry than have little kids be blessed. And the Bible says that Jesus was distraught with the disciples. He was upset with the disciples and said, suffer the little children to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of heaven. Well, the crowd outside of Jericho told Bartimaeus to shut up, to keep silent. I mean, the Bible says it like this. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. In other words, they told him to shut up. We don't have time. Look, we don't have time for blind beggar men, just like we don't have time for kids. We don't have time. We got big things to do here. But the Bible says he cried out the more. He didn't give up. He cried out even louder, stronger, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. He cried out more, and Jesus heard him. Despite all the commotion, despite walking down the roads, despite all the people talking, despite all the people trying to get to Jesus. And there were people there in the crowd, I'm sure, look, I'm worse off than you. I've got to get to Jesus. I've got to get to him. You shut up, let me get to him. Yet Bartimaeus cried out more because Bartimaeus, you know what Bartimaeus saw? Bartimaeus is a blind man. Pardon the play on words. But Bartimaeus saw some things that day the rest of the crowd did not see. That old blind man saw some things that day everybody else didn't see. And he cried out more, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy upon me. And Jesus heard him and stopped and said, bring him over here. And the Bible says that he cast away his cloak. You know what's so amazing about that? That was the thing he had all his money on. But he threw that away because Bartimaeus knew that in a few minutes he wasn't going to need that coat anymore. And he came to Jesus and said, what do you want? And he said, that I might receive my sight, Lord. If I could but get to Jesus. You see, Bartimaeus had evidently heard of Jesus, and now, too good to be true, here he comes down the road, and he cries out, "Have mercy." "What do you want, blind man?" "Lord, that I might receive my sight." And the Bible says this, that Jesus healed him immediately so that he could see. You see, Bartimaeus said, "I just need to get to Jesus." Boy, if he'd ever come around my neighborhood, I believe I would sure try a way to get to him. That woman who was so sick said, "If I could just get to Jesus, I know that I could be made whole." Bartimaeus says, "I know I could see if I could just bring my problem to Jesus." Well, friend, today may I say to you that we can bring it to Jesus because he sits at the right hand of God the Father, where he makes intercession for all those who will come to him. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is just as compassionate as he was in the day of the leper. He is just as helping as the day of that woman with the issue of blood. He is just as healing as he was with Bartimaeus. Oh, if I could just bring my problems to Jesus. Friend, everybody's got problems. Everybody does. But if we can just bring our problems to Jesus, all the broken pieces, good night, friend. He'll pick the broken pieces up. He'll give you life you never knew, sweet love and joy in heaven too. That's what Jesus will do. And he'll do it for you. "Oh, you don't know how bad I've been, preacher. You don't know how many sins I've committed." Don't have to. I know the Apostle Paul said, "I am the chiefest of sinners." And yet Jesus saved him. Friend, your greatest problem is that you're an enemy of God. If you've never been saved, you're an enemy of God. And the Bible says it's a terror to fall into the hands of the living God. Oh, you don't want that to happen. You don't want to fall into God's hands. What you need to do today is come to Christ. "He that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out." He invites you to come. The bride says, "Come." And the Spirit says, "Come." And let him that is athirst come and drink of the water of life freely. You see, it doesn't cost anything. Jesus healed that woman without cost. Jesus healed Bartimaeus without cost. Jesus healed that leper without cost. My friend, Jesus will save you without cost. But you must come. You must trust him. Bartimaeus said, "Well, I wonder if he'll..." No. He will heal me. The woman, "If I could just touch them," he healed her. The leper, "If he'll just have compassion on me," and he healed him. Your problem, your great problem, your sin problem, between you and God, if you just bring it to Christ, "Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I'm sorry for my sin. Lord, I am sorry for my sin. Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Lord, I'm sorry for it. Come into my heart right now and save me. Change my life, make me new, help me to live for you." You see, friend, if you'll come, he'll save you. Just like he healed that woman, like he healed old Bartimaeus, like he healed that leper, he'll do the same for you. But you need to do that today. You need to trust him today. Because listen to me, tomorrow just might be too late.
Friend, did you ever think that you might actually be an enemy of God? Can't say as I've ever thought of that. But if you are a sinner, you are an enemy of God. Then the next question is, how much do you have to sin to be a sinner? You know, just one sin makes you a sinner. But the great news is, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for you, friend. Won't you accept him today? If you would like to know more about how you can accept this free gift of salvation, this free gift of eternal life, why don't you give us a call today? Our phone number here is 315-348-6271, or you can send an email, and that email address is cbclewiscounty@gmail.com. Or even better yet, why don't you come join us today? There's an empty place in a pew that can only be filled by you. Thank you again for joining us this half hour. Lord willing. We will catch you again next week on Heaven Bound.